So is there a difference in HbA1c in switching sulfonin areas in uncontrolled HbA1c after reaching the effective dose of a sulfonin areas?
अच्छा अटैप आफ्टर यूजिंग दी मैक्सिमल डोज ऑफ सल्फोनिल यूरिया नहीं क्वेश्चन इज नॉट क्लियर एक्चुअली हु हैज आस्क्ड दिस क्वेश्चन कैन यू पुट इट इन अ वेरी सिंपलर वे प्लीज
सो टिल देन आई जस्ट रीड आउट द नेक्स्ट क्वेश्चन
या यू कैन रीड आउट द नेक्स्ट क्वेश्चन
सर हाउ टू सिलेक्ट एन ओएचए एंड व्हेन टू मॉनिटर ब्लड शुगर्स व्हेन इनिशिएटिंग ओएचए फॉर फर्स्ट टाइम
अच्छा So any these the OHAs they have a role only in the management of type 2 diabetes mellitus per se that is point number 1 and to start with it is the metformin unless otherwise it is contraindicated or not being tolerated by the patient in the form of gastrointestinal severe disturbance where the patient has got vomitings and the motions you cannot continue the metformin And there are certain conditions, the absolute contraindications for metformin, wherein the eGFR goes below 30 ml per minute per 1.73 meter square. The otherwise contraindicated, the metformin remains the first drug of option. And the second drug of option always is, in our scenario, it is the sulfonylurea or the combination of the combination of metformin with the sulfonylurea. And you measure the baseline HbA1c when the patient comes to you. If you have the facility, you please along with the fasting plasma glucose, along with the 2-hour post plasma glucose, you measure the HbA1c. You should have the baseline HbA1c. You should have the baseline lipid profile. You should have the baseline the kidney function test and the renal function test and including the electrolytes. You should mandatorily have the 12 lead resting electrocardiogram. And these are mandatory, like as per the guidelines of the American Diabetes Association. When you have the baseline the parameters only, you can compare after 3 months or 6 months or 1 year. Suppose the HbA1c, at least what American Diabetes Association says is because it's a costlier one, the test costs a little bit. That is involved with. The money it says at least you have tried to have 2 HbA1c readings in a year so in my practice I do it once in 3 months so you only thing is you should counsel the patient and it's not a big deal to counsel the patient to get the HbA1c done once in 3 months so that you can have a constant monitoring And as like kidney function test at least once in 6 months and the lipid profile at least once in a year and the ECG once in a year and after this combination you can go to the maximal dose like okay you make the metformin start with 1 gram that is 500 milligram in the morning and night you make it 2 grams go to the maximal dose of the Indian maximal dose is 2 grams whereas the western scenario it is the maximal dose of metformin is 2550 milligrams and like you can start with either the glipizide or the glycoside or the even the glimepiride and you can up titrate the dose so as to allow the patient to get back to the normalcy of the fasting plasma glucose and the postprandial plasma glucose and the glycated hemoglobin to the targets without letting down the patient to get into this hypoglycemic episodes and if you are not able to do that you can always have a third agent as an add-on like let it be in a affordable segment it can be either a SGLT2 inhibitor or in a affordable segment it is a DPP4 inhibitor in non-affordable segment it is always the Indian scenario I put it as like the alpha glucosidase inhibitors especially the oglibose they to start with 0.2 and escalating to 0.3 milligram the how you start how you initiate oglibose is an art like you should start with once daily dose of oglibose that is preferably with the first bite after the first bite in the breakfast you start and if the patient is able to tolerate ask the patient to take the second tablet in the afternoon in the second week And if the patient is able to tolerate Voglibose without having any gastrointestinal upsets and problems, you can ask the patient to take the 0.3 milligram of Voglibose three times also. That is how you have to uptitrate the dose of this thing, the Voglibose or even the Acarbose. If people are using Acarbose, it's okay, but I don't use it in my clinical practice because Voglibose is very potent and it has very fewer gastrointestinal side effects also. So that is how I manage. And if the patient is not still to the target, you counsel the patient that you are already on the maximal dose of three oral drugs. It's high time you have to switch over to the insulin. Some form of insulin. The insulin can be initiated with the basal insulin along with the existing OADs. Unless otherwise there is a compelling indication like the short-term complications of hyperglycemia as we discussed, the DKA and HHS, wherein all the oral drugs should be removed, only the regular insulin is to be instituted and the patient might need admission and you have to check his the state of dehydration and the most of the times 99.9% of the DKA patients, they get 100% they get dehydrated, they got some very hyperglycemia like more than 500 or 600 and a precipitated you don't usually find DKA in type 2 diabetes patients unless otherwise there is a precipitating factor like infection where the patient is run down. Per se, let us talk about the COVID-19 scenario itself. Once the patient has COVID, automatically even the patient is normoglycemic, term called the COVID induced hyperglycemia. That is a transient one. That wanes off after 6 weeks or max 3 months or 6 months. But it has got the ability to induce hyperglycemia in a normoglycemic patient. Or the worsening of the glycemic levels in an established type 2 diabetes or type 1 diabetes or even the whatever you call the gestational diabetes mellitus or the secondary forms of diabetes also wherein the patient has got chronic alcoholic pancreatitis or the some malignant tumor in the pancreas where you need to go for a resection. That is, total pancreatectomy used to be done.